Hey, Mr. Drew. In this video, we're going to look at four examples of problems that deal with definite integrals to find areas bound by a function and the x-axis. However, these four examples are going to be like these two up here, where we have we're doing the definite integral from negative 2 to 3 of 6 dx and the definite integral of 0 to 5 of 2x dx. Now, with this constant and this single degree function here, we might not need to go through that limit process that we've been doing in a lot of these videos to find this area. And indeed, let's not forget that we are, you know, trying to find the definite integral of a function. So when you see the integral of 6 dx, you're integrating f of x is equal to 6. And when you're integrating 2x dx, you're really taking the integral of f of x, which is equal to 2x. Now, this is just fancy notation for y, and we're looking at a function, just y equals 6. Well, the function or the graph of y equals 6 is a horizontal line. So let's see what that looks like as a picture. Well, we can see that when we graph y equals 6, here's our horizontal line, and when we mark off the closed interval from negative 2 to 3, which we're finding that definite integral bound by those values, we can see all that we're doing is trying to find the area of a rectangle. So instead of going through that whole limit process and just recognizing that since we're taking the definite integral of a constant, all we're really finding is that area of a rectangle, and that is just the area formula, length times width. So our area is going to be equal to the width of this rectangle, and the distance between negative 2 and 3 is equal to 5. And the height of the rectangle, of course, we have, since, you know, we're bound between the function and the x-axis, we have a height of 6, so our area is equal to 30 square units. Now over here, we have f of x is equal to 2x. So again, let me step out, make you a nice, neat picture, and see what geometric shape we're getting from this single degree function between in the closed interval of 0 to 5. So here we have our picture drawn. We have that y equals 2x, which of course is a line with a slope of 2 and a y-intercept of 0. So when I graph that line and I mark off the closed interval between 0 and 5, we can see that this definite integral of 2x dx between 0 and 5 is just finding the area of a triangle. I don't need to go through the limit process or Riemann sum to figure out that area. I can just do my old school geometry formula, which is area is equal to 1/2 base times height. So it's going to be 1/2, our base of 0 to 5 is 5, and a height of 10. Half of 10 is 5, and 5 times 5 is equal to, of course, 25 units squared. So I got two more examples. One is going to develop into the shape of a trapezoid, another one into the shape of a semicircle. And, you know, I just want to make you think about what it is you're taking the definite integral of. If it's a constant, if it's a single degree, the circles are a little bit trickier to recognize. But if you sketch the area in which you're trying to find the definite integral of, find the area of, you may very well find that you don't need to do quite so much work as we've been doing in the last few videos. Now, a lot of those examples were probably not, you know, able to do it with this kind of simplicity, but when you have the opportunity, please take advantage of it. All right, last two examples. Here we have the definite integral of negative x plus 7 dx from 1 to 4, the closed interval of 1 to 4. Let me step off again, give you a nice neat picture, and, you know, recognize that shape and apply the correct geometric formula, because this, once again, will not need to go through that long limit process. Or you might want to just pause the video real quick and try it yourself before I give you the answer. Okay, so we have now, you can see that when we have this closed interval between 1 and 4 and how it's bound by the function in the x-axis, that we have the shape of a trapezoid. Now, the area of a trapezoid is equal to, in case you've forgotten, one half the height times b1 plus b2. So now the bases on a trapezoid, those are the two sides that are parallel. Normally we see those as horizontal. So you might want to think of this picture being rotated 90 degrees in either direction, or just recognize that these two parallel sides are going to act as the bases of your trapezoid. And that comes out to be 1/2. The height, well, from 1 to 4, if you were to lay it down on its parallel sides, 4 minus 1 is equal to 3, so our height is 3. And I'm writing it like that. And the bases, well, let's see here. We go from, at this x value of 1, we have a y value of 0, and we go up to 6, so that's a height of 6, plus this height here. When we take the x value of 4 and we plug it into our function, negative 4 plus 7 is equal to 3, so that height is equal to 3. This is 1/2 3 times 6 plus 3, which is equal to 9, and that is 1/2 of 3 times 9 is 27. So of course we have 27 over 2 units squared for this definite integral, which is representing this area. Over here we have the definite integral of the square root of 9 minus x squared dx from the boundary of negative 3 and 3. So this might look like a question that you need to go through the limit process, or definition of area, the Riemann sum, whatever your teacher's calling it. Definition of area is just a specialized case or a specific case of Riemann sum. So if we take this out again, remembering that we're taking the integral of a function, we have f of x is equal to 9 minus x squared, the square root. Okay, well, if you'd like, if you don't recognize what that shape is, I'm gonna do two things at once. I'm gonna square both sides to get rid of the radical, the square root symbol, and I'm also gonna write f of x as y. So we're gonna take this function, we are going to square both sides of it, and we get y squared, and the power of 2, of course, and the square root are gonna cancel out. Those are inverse functions, so we have 9 minus x squared. And we have an equation now with two squared terms, the x is squared and the y is squared, which means it could be a circle, which is a specialized type of ellipse, or it could be a hyperbola. Hopefully it's nothing that fancy, because we won't be able to just take a basic area formula from geometry to solve it. But if we do take x squared and we add it to both sides, we get x squared plus y squared is equal to 9. So this is... we have two squared terms, we have leading coefficients which are equal, and the denominators are also equal if you're trying to pull back some concepts from learning your conic sections from Algebra 2 Honors or Precalculus or somewhere in there. And we have a 9 at the end, so we have a center, we have a circle whose center is equal to 0, 0, and whose radius is equal to the square root of 9, which is going to be equal to 3. Now, I did say we have a circle, but I'm not going to draw an entire circle when I put this graph up here in a second. The reason why is I've manipulated the equation a little bit just to allow you to see what the actual shape of the function is, or the graph is, but the original equation was what f of x, or y, is equal to the square root of 9 minus x squared. Now, the author, the textbook, I made up the question, but as you're looking through your textbook, when you see that square root in your textbook and there's, no sign in front of it, they're not expecting you again to use both the positive and negative answer. They're only expecting you to use the positive answer, right? Like the square root of 16 is 4 and negative 4. But if the book says square root of 16, period, f, I guess it could be f of x equals square root of 16. They only want that, what is it called, the principal answer, the principal square root, the positive square root. If they wanted you to use the negative answers, they'd write negative square root of blank, or they would do plus or minus if they wanted you to use both. Now that's different than if you were to start here and solve this for y. If you were to start here and put your own square root into the function, then you would have to include both a positive and negative answer. But when your textbook gives you the square root symbol only, or any even root with no sign in front, we are only using the principal square root or the positive square root. All right, so let me get that picture drawn for you. Okay, so I've got my semicircle drawn, and I don't need vertical lines defining the closed interval in which I'm trying to find the definite integral, because while the function ends, or, well, if you read left to right, sort of begins at negative 3 and ends at negative 3, so we don't need those vertical lines to define that closed interval, and indeed, if it were, probably would have to go through the limit process or the Riemann sum process to find the area, or to find that definite integral representing that area. However, we don't. So we just find the area of a circle, which is equal to pi r squared. Now, again, I don't want an entire circle. I just want a semicircle or half of that. So I'm going to divide it by 2. And so our answer comes out to be the area is equal to the radius, which again was equal to 3. So we have pi times 3 squared over 2. And 3 squared is equal to 9. So we have 9 pi over 2. And I'm putting the square unit here because, again, we're using a definite integral to find that area bound by the function and the x-axis. And so since we're identifying area, then it's square units for the unit of measure. So I'm Mr. True. That's the end of my video for finding areas of common geometric regions when you're doing definite integrals. So, time for you to go do your homework.